Hi, I'm Eric Kurland, and I want to welcome you to this final block here in the 2021 3DCon Streaming 3D Theater. As always, we have two streams available for you to choose. You can select the side-by-side stream to watch on 3D TVs, or you can select the Anaglyph stream, put on your Anaglyph glasses with the red lens over your left eye, and watch this on computers, phones, and tablets in Anaglyph. We have a really great program for you in this block, and we're going to get things started with a preview of the 2022 3DCon. So I'd like to introduce the chair of next year's convention, Phyllis Maslin.
Hello, Greg Perez and I would like to invite you to join us for a live 3DCon in Tacoma, Washington in August of 2022. It will be held in the beautiful Murano Hotel, which features a glass artist on each of its 25 floors. We will have the same events that we have at most 3DCons, including stereo theater, workshops, meetings, guest speakers, and of course, social gatherings. We also plan an all-day trip to Mount Rainier and another all-day trip to the Seattle Center, which will include the Chihuly Garden and Glass. The iconic Space Needle will be there, as is the Pacific Science Center, all of which are awesome opportunities for photos. We also plan a walking tour of Point Defiance Park, and there may be some other surprises coming along too. So please plan on joining us August 1st through the 8th, 2022 for a live 3DCon. We look forward to seeing you and hope that you can plan extra time to vacation in the beautiful Pacific Northwest. Enjoy.
Hello, I'm Jay Horwitz, a member of the Ohio Stereophotographic Society. I'm retired from NASA's Glenn Research Center in Cleveland, Ohio, where I established a lab for doing advanced scientific visualization and pioneered some of the agency's early work in immersive virtual reality. This gave me the opportunity to play with some of the great toys they had and rekindled my interest in all things stereoscopic. For the past several years, I've presented at the 3DCon videos highlighting our club's annual Ohio International Stereo Exhibition. I've wrapped the display of the images in various whimsical themes. I like to think of these themes as similar to the frames around artwork in a museum. They attract your attention and get you to focus on the important stuff inside, which in this case are some of the best photographs taken by some of the best stereo photographers in the world. Yesterday, we showed part one, which had an open theme. This time, we're going to show part two, which highlights themes of action. And hope you enjoy it. Hope you have got a couple pennies left from yesterday, and enjoy the show.
Hello, my name is David Carlton Bright. I'm a videographer and I've been doing 3D for about 20 years. And the digital era has opened up a whole new area, I think, for creative work. What you're going to see is all still images, all 3D still images, which I've layered and composed so that they have like a, they kind of tell a story in a way. The music is three or four layers of the solfeggio frequencies, which I changed and tweaked as the piece went. It's called the Solfeggio Suite, and it has four movements at this point, possibly five, and it's going to go about 35 minutes altogether. This is the first movement, and it relays or deals with the climate change and the plastic in the oceans, that type of thing. That's the basic theme. Thanks.
Hello, everyone. This is Robert Davis. I wanted to thank you for checking out my Richmond Belle Isle video. This was part of a series of videos I did in and around Richmond about the history and historically significant locations. And Belle Isle, for sure, is one of the most important locations to Richmond. It took about a week to shoot it. This is probably the longest shooting that I've done for a video. And I've never really had sat down to script out a video and do research before. I worked on a previous video called The Churchill Tunnel, which I always had wanted to do a Belle Isle documentary, but it just seemed like this huge daunting task because there was so much to cover. And even my video is kind of like a skeleton outline. There's just a lot that happened there. But after doing the Churchill Tunnel video, I had the confidence to go forward and do the Belle Isle one. And it was several day shoot. I had to reshoot a lot of things because it's right there on the James River and it was very windy. And some days were windier than others, but it came out amazingly. I was very thankful for the local band. They're called Minor Poet for allowing me to use their song River Days, which is specifically about the James River in the video. I think it's just a perfect song. And I really liked showing people this environment in 3D. There's a lot to see on Belle Isle. There's a lot of old structures, and I really feel like the 3D helps bring these structures to life. With that being said, I hope you guys enjoy it. I hope you guys learn something new. And if you're interested in learning more, you can always check out all the resources that I have posted as sources at the end of the video. Thank you.
Over the raging Hollywood Rapids on the James River, nestled between downtown Richmond and Southside, is Belle Isle. And Belle Isle is just that, a beautiful island. But over its 400-year history, it's been a house of many people. From the Native Americans that settled in this area in pre-colonial times, to the skilled bikers of today, there's a lot to see, so let's jump right in.
Earliest accounts of Belle Isle say that Native Americans lived on this land. This was a prime area for fishing, and Native Americans used fishing traps called weirs. From 1607 to 1608, John Smith, one of the leaders of Jamestown, was part of a group of men who planned to explore and chart the Chesapeake area. Early on in 1607, John Smith and his crew came upon Belle Isle, or as they would refer to it as, Broad Rock Island. This is due to the large and wide rocks that you can see in and around the island, not unlike the rock structure you can see behind me. From now on, I will refer to Belle Isle as Broad Rock Island, until the point in time in history where the island began to be referred to as Belle Isle.
In 1676, William Byrd I acquired the island for the settlers. And in 1742, his son William Byrd II established Richmond on the north bank of the James. His family sold Broad Rock Island to entrepreneur John Harvey in 1776, whose heirs in turn sold it to John and Gabriella Brockenbrough, who leased the island out to Jacqueline B. Harvey, Philip Thornton, and John Humes. I know these are a lot of names and passing of the island's ownership, but it is important to understand these building blocks for the events to come.
Taking a leaf out of the Native Americans' book, the settlers' first operation here was a fishery. However, the first real businesses wouldn't start until the early 1800s. Once this island was sold and leased, a mill, a mill race, houses, a dam, and iron and nail factories were constructed here. These were constructed between 1814 and 1836. Two of these buildings were constructed specifically by two separate companies. In 1814, the Old Dominion Iron and Nail Company constructed one, and in 1815, the Belle Isle Rolling, Milling, and Slitting Manufactory constructed the other. This brick wall here is what is left of the latter, and this building was powered by the mill race, which is seen behind it. The metal tunnel here housed the turbine, which was moved by water. In turn, this turbine moved a series of belts that helped power the manufactory. Behind me is a remnant of the Old Dominion Iron and Nail Company. This metal frame used to be a part of a factory that constructed tank parts for Chrysler Motors during World War I. It was jokingly referred to as the Chrysler Building. In 1836, the Belle Isle Manufacturing Company would acquire the ironworks, and this is when Broad Rock Island would start to be referred to as Belle Isle. However, in 1851, the Old Dominion Iron and Nail Company would buy the Belle Isle Manufacturing Company. Sometime in the 1850s, a railroad spur connecting to the Danville and Richmond Railroad was built from the south bank of the James River onto the south end of Belle Isle. The railroad spur was later extended through the north end of Belle Isle, across this train trestle to the north bank of the James River. This train bridge would become very important later. The quarries behind me were in operation from the early to mid 1800s. They were used to gather granite, which was a very popular building material at the time. However, granite would soon fall out of favor to concrete. The reason these quarries are now filled with water is because when the prospectors were mining them out, they hit two cracks that allowed water from the James River to seep in.
The base for the steam-powered equipment for the quarries still exists.
The 1860s found our country in a great turmoil. The American Civil War had begun, and Richmond was named capital of the South. In June of 1862, the Confederacy opened a prisoner of war camp on the island for prisoner exchanges with the North. 5,000 men were brought here, and by September 23rd of the same year, most of the men had been exchanged and the camp was closed. It wasn't closed for long, however, as on January 17th, 1863, prisoner exchanges stopped and the camp was reopened, but soon closed again. On May 13th, 1863, the camp reopened once more, but the prisoner exchanges soon broke down and were no longer made. February of 1864 saw the Confederates evacuating Belle Isle and sending the Union prisoners south, and in October of that year, the island was completely evacuated and the camp was closed for good. Richmond fell to the Union on April 2nd, 1865. Sadly, due to severe overcrowding, many Union soldiers were left to battle the elements and disease, practically sleeping in holes in the ground. Many would pass away in these camps due to poor conditions. Around 20,000 Union prisoners were brought through the camp throughout the war.
the Union soldiers were buried on the island here, but the bodies were later moved. This pit here is not part of Belle Isle's natural structure. It was dug out by the Confederacy during the Civil War, when Belle Isle was being used as a prisoner of war camp. The intention was to place large cannons here to protect the isle from attack from the Union. However, due to the Hollywood Rapids being so ravaged, attack from the north was virtually impossible, and cannons were never placed here. After the war, Belle Isle's industry continued to thrive. In 1876, the Ironworks Oil House was constructed to hold flammable materials and dangerous acids for the ironworks on the island. During the mid to 1980s, while the Robert E. Lee Memorial Bridge was being reconstructed, the stone slab roofing of the Oil Works building was removed, and the Oil Works building was completely buried in sand to protect it from the construction. In 1904, the Upper Appomattox Company created the Belle Isle Hydroelectric Power Plant. This was a marvel in technology, as it was one of the first in the country. While not the first, the first hydro plant was constructed in Richmond along the canal. This plant was used to power factories on Belle Isle and in Richmond. It was also used to power the trolley system. That's right. In the early 1900s, we had a hydroelectric power plant, clean renewable energy, powering a public transportation system. In 1925, the Virginia Electric Power Company, or VEPCO, would buy this power plant.
Today, we can still see the gates used to keep the debris out, as well as the gate cleaner used to clear the debris away. It rode on the rails placed on this wall and used its metal teeth to clear away debris. The electricity poles and bases can still be seen around and on the island.
In 1963, the hydroelectric power plant was shut down due to high upkeep. Having to constantly remove debris from the gates proved difficult, and river silt from the James River would wear down the generator blades. This could make them unstable. The generator and the blades were later moved to Peru, where they are still being used today. Moving forward, Richmond went with fossil fuels, which is very unfortunate, as the hydro plant provided clean, renewable energy to the city. Just a year later, in 1964, the Arab oil embargo began, which greatly raised the price of oil. Had the plant held on for just a little bit longer, it might have still been in use for many years. In 1972, the ironworks and the other factories followed suit and shut down, shortly followed by the railway line. In 1973, the island became a park. But without a train, how did people get here? Let's take things back a bit and talk about the bridge that towers over Belle Isle, known as the Robert E. Lee Bridge. In its earliest incarnation, it was a small wooden bridge called the James River Bridge. On November 4th, 1934, it was dedicated as the Robert E. Lee Memorial Bridge. A month later, in December, tolls were installed.
In 1985, plans were put into motion to rebuild the bridge. It went over budget, and when it was finished construction in 1988, it cost $43.5 million.
Originally, people that wanted to go to Belle Isle Park had to traverse across the old train bridge, the one that I talked about earlier. However, not too long after the Robert E. Lee Bridge's reconstruction, a pedestrian bridge was installed underneath it, and on April 30th, 1991, this new bridge was dedicated, and now people were able to get to the island in a whole new way.
While the railroad trestle is no longer used and gone from the north end of Belle Isle, the railroad trestle from the south end of Belle Isle is still there, and you can still use it to get onto the island.
Currently, there are talks of reverting the name of the Robert E. Lee Bridge back to the James River Bridge.
1993 saw the construction of the Nature Center and toilet, which is used as a storage house of sorts today.
In 1995, Belle Isle, along with the other islands on the James River, were
inducted into the National Register of Historic Places as significant historical sites.
In the fall of 2001, parts of the movie Hannibal were shot here in Richmond, and Belle Isle made a cameo appearance.
In early 2009, a 3-foot-long piece of concrete fell from above from the Robert E. Lee Bridge, hitting the pedestrian bridge. It was shut down for several months as construction was done to make the pedestrian bridge safe again, and for many years to come, scaffolding was placed right here to protect the bridge from any more debris that might fall.
Also, in 2009, Belle Isle became a part of the James River Park System Conservation.
Despite industry having left Belle Isle many years ago, there is still a lot to see here and to do. Bikers like to ride around the island, and there is even a bike school area for true daredevils. Many people use Belle Isle as a launch point for kayaking the Hollywood Rapids. You can picnic, run, and dog walk. And with all the ruins, you can take a walk through not just Belle Isle's history, but Richmond's history. Some of these structures have been here for over 200 years. And while many things have come and gone over the years, it seems that Richmond's love of Belle Isle is here to stay.
John Smith, one of the leaders of Jamestown, was part of a group of
I'm gonna put it over here.
Hello, I'm Ryan Suits. I'm the director and cinematographer, etc. of Best Buds, a short you're about to watch. The film was made for a short film competition called Spliff and has screened at a few online festivals, but only in 2D. You were the first ones to see it in full 3D. We shot it in March 2020, pre all the shutdown, with Canon 5D Mark IIIs and a 3D Film Factory beam splitter rig. And it's made up of a series of long exposure light painting photos.
Benoit. I'm the founder of National 3D Day and also of ParallaxShift.com. The first video that we're looking at is basically an exploration into stereoscopic communications. It is made from a succession of photographs that were taken from a single vantage point where no stereoscopic information was present. The only stereoscopic information that you see is actually from the subject matter of a train passing behind the train that I was in, with the windows illuminating from behind it. So the stereoscopic information that you see is basically from the train, the subject matter being moving in a lateral way and taking basically successive photographs the same way that you would take a cha-cha, but instead taking a still cha-cha, but with the subject matter moving. So these stereos are basically an experiment in preconceived memories and basically preconceived information that would be added to a stereoscopic view. Basically, we take out all visual information in this set of in this case, and we're only using the black silhouettes of two very readily known cartoon characters, Daffy Duck and Bugs Bunny, and since they have no other visual information to add to the stereoscopic story that you would get in your head from visually seeing it, this is a very good exercise to see how much your brain actually fills in for predicting what you think you're going to see and what you actually do see stereoscopically. Okay, so this is a short video. This is very fun. It's not my footage. This is from an Instagram account. I guess it's pronounced Meishley. The information will be provided for you if you want to click on him. I need credit for him, for his work. This is basically experiment in binocular rivalry using two almost identical models walking their model walk with enough disparity and enough visual similarity between the images that you should you should be able to keep the model's clothes on. And this is basically an experiment in to see if you could see any, there really is no stereoscopic information, although some pieces do look stereoscopic, some pieces don't. But basically this is a very good exercise in binocular rivalry and in visual thresholds, our own personal visual thresholds, which we each have. Okay. So that Dropped Orange is just a 1 minute short that I was doing. I was doing a lot of stereoscopic shorts from old clubbing footage since it's been a minute and a half since I stepped foot in a club. And that is just basically unusable footage that was too dark or too, basically too dark that I really couldn't use in any other method besides just combining it in filtering it in creative ways. And I titled it Dropped Orange because at the beginning of the video, apparently I dropped my orange at the club, which I always do. So that's it. It's just a creative little clubbing video for me to be happy with.
My name is Hermine Raab. I am a professional mathematician, and since 1997, I am very fond of the stereoscopy photos. And since then, it is really becoming a passion of me. I love traveling, and so I have a lot of 3D images. And one of the most lovely cities I've ever been is Naples. And of course, I am not speaking of Naples in Florida, but Naples in Italy. A very old town, about 2,000 years old already, or even more, and has quite a lot of cultural sites, but also I like the Dolce Far Niente in Italy. I like the Tartu Tine in Italy. I like the pizza and the spaghetti and all those things. And so I'm really in love with Naples. And not only me, but also Goethe. Goethe, a very famous German author, and he wrote the famous words, see Naples and die. And this is what we like to show, what I like to show. Thank you. Thank you.
Naples is one of the oldest continuously inhabited urban areas in the world. During the 6th century before Christ, the Greek founded Neapolis, the new city, but later it was destroyed by earthquakes, mudslides, and volcanic ash. The Romans rebuilt the town. Naples was expanded with elegant Roman villas, aqueducts, and public baths. In Pozzuoli, they built the amphitheater, the third largest in Italy. But again, fate struck. 79 years after Christ, the eruption of Vesuvius destroyed everything. Bombay was completely buried and forgotten for 1700 years. Even within a radius of 35 kilometers to the Vesuvius, the ash was still half a meter high. The Neapolitans rebuilt Naples on rubble and ashes. The city itself is a unique experience. Nowhere have I felt life as much as in the streets and alleys of Naples.
Come sei bella, più bella stasera, Mario. Splende un sorriso di stella negli occhi tuoi blu. Anche se adesso il destino domani sarà, oggi ti sono vicino perché sospirar non pensar. Parlami d'amore, Mario. Tutta la mia vita sei tu, gli occhi tuoi belli brillano, fiamme di sogno scintillano.
The Neapolitans are very devout people. First comes family, then food, amore, and then faith. A scene from everyday life, typically Neapolitan. There are vitrines with images of saints on every corner and in every house.
Parlami d'amore, Mario.
Thank you.
The Italian sees Naples as a piece of heaven fallen to earth. One can't blame the Neapolitan for never wanting to leave his city, even if a few more Vesuviuses were to rise in the neighborhood.
And that brings us to the end of the streaming 3D theater sessions at the 2021 National Stereoscopic Association's 3DCon. I hope you liked everything that we had here in the theater for the last 3 days, and I really want to thank all of our presenters. It was so great to be able to show all of your work here in the theater. I want to remind everyone watching that these streams will be active through the end of the convention. So if there's anything you missed or something you want to go back and watch again, you still have a little bit of time to do that. Thank you so much to everyone who tuned in to watch. Enjoy the rest of the convention. Bye.